His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is He.
Search me, oh God, yes, Lord, and know my heart today. Try me, oh precious Savior. My thoughts, I pray, see if there would be some wicked, wicked way in me. Cleanse me, cleanse me from every sin and set me free. I thank you, Lord, for cleansing me from sin. Fulfill, yes, your glorious, glorious word, and make me pure within. Fill me with your fire, where I once, oh, burned with shame. Grant, O Lord, grant my desire to magnify your name. Lord, take my life. And make it wholly thine. Fill my poor heart with your great love divine. Take all my will, my passion, self, and pride. I now surrender all to you, Lord, from the deep of my heart. I give you myself, my all in all. Lord, in me abide. Oh, Holy Spirit, revival comes from thee. Send a revival. And O Lord, start your work. Oh, in me. Your word, it declares that you will supply and meet our every need. Yes, you will, Lord. For blessings now. Oh, my Lord, I am. Thank you. blessings. Blessings now. Oh, precious Lord, I humbly plead.
Well, good morning, and thank you for joining us. We hope you've been enjoying this nice weather we've had this week, and it's given you cause to be happy. But you know, the Bible commands us to be happy. It says rejoice. The Bible tells us to rejoice. I like the word re. That means you do it again and again. You know, Maloliad, who's only 3 years of age, has been in touch with us this week, and out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, you know, we got wisdom. Let's listen to what Maloliad has to say to us.
I rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it, I can rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice in the Lord always. The Lord is near. 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 Philippians 4:4-5. God bless you. Bye.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that. Thank you very much, Maloliad, and thank you, Teklu, for helping with animation. Well, we're going to have some time in the Word of God, and we're going to breathe a prayer. Let's pray, shall we? Father in heaven, we come before you in Jesus' name. We ask you to look upon your people at this time, and we ask you, Lord, to hear our cries. We need your help for our nation. Lord, we need your help for our fellowship. And Lord, there are those in particular who need special help. And Lord, we cry to you along with others, with the saints, Lord. And we make our petition known to you this morning. And we ask that your answer will come. Lord, we thank you for that song that says, the answer's on the way, this I know. Jesus said it, I believe it, and it's so. And we ask, Lord, that you'll just give us confidence that you're attending to our cries. We ask this in the name of your Son, Lord Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that your name will be uplifted. Amen. Well, we've been spending time in the books of Kings. We're in 2 Kings. And last week we were looking at 2 Kings 17. And one of these pause moments. You know, when I studied media studies, they told me in every film, there's always a little part where it's really like the sermon. And if you watch, now I've wasted it for you, if you watch your TV programmes, you'll always see a wee part where they're given the internalised message of the programme they've made. And they've got a name for it. I just happen to forget what it's called. Well, that's what it is, chapter 17. Is the pause to say, look, this is what happened. You've seen it happen, you've heard about it, and this is why it happened. And this is the message that you've got to take from it. And of course, the message was that God was determined to remove this people from his presence because he'd done so much for them. He'd given them his word, he'd given them deliverance, and yet they had turned time and time and time again to wickedness and evil. And forgot their God. And we're always challenged to take up our cross daily and follow Christ. Every day is a new day and we have to serve him. And we have to remember that we live in the light of the Lord. Well, we're going to move on. We saw that the 10 tribes were taken away, never to return. But also Judah, who still remained, was still deep in sin as well. And the Lord was determined to remove them from his presence too. However, the Lord has a covenant with his people. And through this people, through the seed of Abraham, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And we've been blessed because of Jesus, who came as the Messiah, the promised one. So we're moving on, looking at Judah. Now, Judah's a little bit better on the scorecard. We see a couple of good kings, but a lot of bad ones. And I'd like to read to us tonight from chapter 20, a particular story I want to focus into. It's to do with Hezekiah's illness. You probably know the story well. But we'll speedily look at that and look by it. Hezekiah was a good king. He did a lot to honour the Lord and to give God his place. And he feared the Lord. You know, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And we pray for our nation. You know, we pray that this COVID-19 will be eradicated. We pray that people will come back to church. We pray all sorts of things. But the first thing we should pray for is that the fear of God will come upon this nation. For the Bible says, you know, it's the Holy Spirit who brings a conviction of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment to come. And without a move of the Holy Spirit, we can be a wee bit more sensible about it. We can be a wee bit more animated about it. But we need repentance, and repentance comes when people have the fear of God. Well, Hezekiah feared God, and God heard his cry. God delivered him. There was a deliverance for Samaria once more, an incredible deliverance, where God moved mightily and the enemies were slain by God. But you know, Hezekiah, he took ill and he cried to God. We're going to come to that. And his life was extended, as you probably know the story. But he had a son called Manasseh, who took them right back and worse. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord. He spilled innocent blood in Jerusalem. He was a wicked, wicked man, a murderous man, a man that God was saying, yes, it's still going to happen. You're going to be all be removed from my presence. He took them right back to worshipping the Baal and the other gods and doing evil and violence. And while Manasseh's time came, he came and went, and other kings came along. And of course, we're living under the threat of emerging powers, and Hezekiah entertained an envoy from Babylon, which was a small principality at the time. The big threat was Assyria, which had come against the northern tribes and had deported them. They were the power, but Babylon was going to rise, and in the future they would be taken away. You know that hymn, by the rivers of Babylon, there I sat down, yea, I wept when I remember Zion. You know, the thing is about people who live now, pay later. They pay later. I'm going to tell you that. Live now, pay later means you pay later. And the later was coming, and it would come for Judah when they'd be deported to Babylon. But you know, they moved on, and Hezekiah was a good king. He died. Manasseh was a bad king. And there were various other bad kings. There was Josiah was a good king. He found the scroll in the temple, and they read the scroll, and conviction came through reading the word. They rediscovered the word. And I could I say something to Christians? There are Christians in their multitudes who need to rediscover the word and understand that what they hold in their hands is God-breathed. God-breathed. It's not a book. It's a book that is God-breathed, and we need to rediscover the word. He rediscovered the word, and it brought about a big change. And then him being an authority, He brought back the reforms. We need a reformation once more, a holy reformation. And reformation takes you back to the commands of the Lord. So anyway, time goes on, and we read also about a man called Jehoiachin, who he was a vassal to Assyria, but he noised them up, as it were, and they came against him. And instead of him fighting, he actually went out the gates and surrendered personally with his mother and his attendants and his officials. And Jehoiachin was taken away to Babylon, and the king of Assyria put Jehoiachin's uncle in charge and gave him a new name, called him Zedekiah. And Zedekiah was a bad article. He did wicked in the eyes of the Lord, and of course things went bad for him. They actually got full of himself, and he rebelled because they were a vassal state, and they rebelled against this great power that was tolerating them, that had this uneasy truce. And they came against him and surrounded the city, and they took him prisoner. And terrible things were done in these days. Zedekiah was taken away with his family, and they actually killed his sons in front of him. And then after they killed his sons in front of him, they took his eyes out. So that was the last thing he ever saw, was the murder of his own children. And sin is hard a taskmaster. The wages of sin is death. And if he'd only honoured the Lord and did you know what Josiah did and what Hezekiah did, but no. But eventually it ends up that Judah falls, and it ends in a bad note, in a bad position. But we know the promise is somewhere in the background. In fact, in chapter 25, the last chapter, we read a wonderful wee story where Nebuchadnezzar is actually replaced by another king, and it's King Marduk, I believe his name is. I'll tell you in a moment. Zedekiah rebelled, and but we read that this new king comes, and he releases. His name was Merodach, and he releases Jehoiachin from the jail. And he'd been 37 years in the jail, and obviously given up, as it were. 37 years, you know, in the Bible, 40 years is a time of trial. Well, he was 37 years in the jail, but then he was released, and he was given a prominent position at the king's table and a daily allowance, and he had a quality of life again. And the book ends with that wee hope. Now, there's nothing phenomenal, fantastic, but there's a tiny baby step to restoration that this king, maybe it's because he did something honourable, I don't know. But let's have a wee look at, for our last look in the book of Kings, I want to look at chapter 20. So you have your Bible, if you turn to chapter 20 of 2 Kings. In those days, Hezekiah became ill and was at the point of death. The prophet Isaiah, son of Amos, went to him and said, "This is what the Lord says, put your house in order, because you're going to die. You will not recover." Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. "Remember, O Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion, and have done what is good in your eyes." And Hezekiah wept bitterly. Before Isaiah had left the middle court, the word of the Lord came to him, "Go back and tell Hezekiah, the leader of my people, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I have heard your prayer and seen your tears. I will heal you on the third day. From now, you will go up to the temple of the Lord. I will add 15 years to your life, and I will deliver you in this city from the hand of the king of Assyria. I will defend this city for my sake and for the sake of my servant David. Then Isaiah said, prepare a poultice of figs. They did so and applied it to the boil, and he recovered. Hezekiah had asked Isaiah, what will be the sign that the Lord will heal me and that I will go up to the temple of the Lord on the third day from now? Isaiah answered, this is the Lord's sign to you, that the Lord will do what he has promised. Shall the shadow go forward 10 steps or shall it go back 10 steps? It's a simple matter for the shadow to go forward 10 steps, said Hezekiah. Rather have it go back 10 steps. Then the prophet Isaiah called upon the Lord, and the Lord made the shadow go back the 10 steps it had gone down on the stairway of Ahaz. Amen. God will bless that reading to us. So here we have this wonderful story of the healing of Hezekiah. Now, last week we were talking about looking death in the face. That was one of the sentiments that we were expressing and considering. And today I want you to consider looking God in the face. Looking God in the face. Now, Hezekiah was a good man, and he served God. And why did that happen to me? You know, why is it, there used to be a saying in this country, good people die young. You know, people can be wicked and evil and do all sorts of terrible things and live a long life. But of course, the psalmist David said, he sent them in slippery places. As one that awakes out of a dream, they will awake, because they're only sliding into judgment. But you know, there is no guarantee that troubles will not come our way because we're serving God. And Hezekiah must have developed some kind of tumour. We read about it in the word here as a boil. Now, I don't know anybody's died with a boil. Obviously, something had come up in his body. And it's interesting that not only did Isaiah proclaim the word of God, but he actually did something practical. He administered this medication, and the medication, in response to what God was doing, healed him in 3 days. But it was the word of the Lord that came, and it was the Lord that healed him, because he was terminal. It was a terminal illness. And I want you to consider this, and I want you to think about this. This man was a king. But you know, the story goes about the king who thought he could command the tide. Can't remember his name, but I read about it. It's a fable. And they sat him down at the tide, at the sea, and he commanded the tide to go back. And of course, the tide didn't go back, and he got his feet wet. So even kings are subject to nature. Even kings are subject to illness. Even kings cannot usurp their authority over the natural things that attack our lives. And also, as Christians, we can be subjected to testing and trials. Well, what happened was, he became ill and Isaiah came to see him. I like Isaiah. To me, he's one of the best fellows in the whole Bible. Not only what he wrote, which is phenomenal, which he underpins scripture and gives it a validity that cannot be paralleled by any other book in the world that's regarded as being a scripture or a holy book. His prophecies were so to the point and so accurate. And the thread of the Messiah running through Isaiah's writing. But he also was a man of action. He was a man who was in touch with God, who heard the word of God and obeyed the word of God and spoke the word of God. Oh, that we had men of God like that once more. He was God's voice piece at this time. And he came to the king and he said to the king, set your house in order, you're going to die. A lot of us are sorting our houses just now. I was thinking about that. We're clearing out the loft and clearing out the garage and clearing out the hut. I said, jinx, if anything happened to us now, we could sell the house, no bother, because everyone's cleared out. Well, Hezekiah was told, set your house in order, because you're going to die. Your time's come. And we read that As I had just delivered the message, he was a message boy, that's all he was. He went out, it wasn't a nice message. You know, people want to be prophets, but in the Bible, prophets say, some of the people, they were always getting killed, murdered, and always had bad news to tell folk. There's nothing nice about being a prophet, other than you're obeying God, and it's good to obey the Lord. Well, when he left, we read in the Bible that Hezekiah turned his face to the wall. He must have had a bed that was up against the wall. His bed couldn't have been sitting in the middle of the room. It must have been in a corner or something. And maybe he would lie looking out in his palace. But this time he turned his head round and he wasn't looking at his palace. He wasn't looking at his people. He was looking at the wall. Now you know what that means, don't you? He wasn't looking at anything. He was looking beyond everything. He was looking to his God. And there comes a time like that in life, in crisis, when you maybe get a crisis in your life. I remember when I got told my young sister had cancer and she was dying. When I would pray, I would shut myself out and I wasn't praying in a prayer meeting. I was crying, it was between me and God. I was calling to God for my sister. There's a time like that when you go face to face with God. It's when you ask for somebody, you make a phone call and you say, I want a favour off you. And the guy says, well, I'll let you know. You write a letter and they write back and say, well, I'll let you know. But when you go to their door and walk into their house and you stand face to face and you say, this is what I'm looking for, it becomes more difficult for the person to refuse you. And I want to challenge us as a church to start talking to God face to face. Now, Hezekiah wept bitterly. And if we mean business, we do it with tears. God reads the heart. You know, God can often answer a prayer even before it gets to the lips. The prayer comes from the heart and that's what he answers. I remember when I was a young guy, and I was a young guy one time, a friend of mine, he had gone down to painting in Devon. He was working with a beach mission team and he says, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm not doing anything. He said, come on down and visit us. I said, okay, I'll come down. But I didn't have any money. I didn't have much money. I was young at the time. I had a job, but I wasn't earning much. So I got my backpack and I hitchhiked all the way to Devon. I'd been over in London visiting my brother and then I headed off to Devon. And boy, it was hot. You know, we've had some lovely weather this week and it was very, very hot. But you know, I was stuck in this road, I still remember it, and there was hardly a bit of traffic on this road I was on. I don't know how I ended up in it. There was a petrol station. I said, how the heck am I going to get a lift from here? To get to painting down in Devon, Torquay area, to meet up with this fella and this beach mission team. And I had a lot of tracks with me and I had actually a wee loudspeaker. I was doing open air preaching as I travelled. And I had a big banner on the back of my backpack. It said, Travelling for Jesus, on the back of my backpack. Young guy. And I was sitting in this petrol station trying to get a lift and there was hardly a car in the petrol station. Anyway, eventually this car came in and the fella filled up with petrol and I was sitting at the exit, as you do. And the fella was driving a wee MG sports car. And it was so hot, he had the soft top down. And I was sitting at the corner. And when he got to the corner, to turn onto the road, he had to look to the right to see if any traffic was coming. And because he was in a low down car and I was sitting low down on a rucksack, he actually was about a yard from me and our eyes were staring into each other. I could have told you the colour of his eyes and he could have told you the colour of my eyes. And he looked at me and I've got my thumb up sitting on my backpack and he just looked at me and I said, well, how about it? I didn't need to shout, I didn't need to say anything. And he looked at me. He says, oh, get in, he says, get in the car. And I suddenly realised as we were tearing down the road and this thing could move, that guy wouldn't have given me a lift. if I was not looking him in the eye to ask him. I was looking him in the eye, and that's why I got the lift. And you know, I learned something from that. You know, sometimes we put buffer zones between us and the world. Sometimes you don't hear the cry of other people because you've got all these buffer zones up. You've got, I've got to do this. I've got to do that. I've got, why don't you hear the voice of God? Maybe God's got something for you to do. I wonder if Isaiah wanted to do his washing that day and he was told, go to the king and tell him he's going to die. And I'll just do my washing. Well, no, he was obedient to the voice of God. And the Lord heard Hezekiah's cry, and immediately the voice piece of God, and thank God that God has prophets who are functioning fully at the command of God. He hadn't even got out of the building, and the Lord said, go back, and I've changed my mind. And Hezekiah went back, and he said to him, you're not going to die. In three days, you'll be able to go up to the temple, which was a good thing. He's going to live, and the first thing he's to do was to go to the house of God. Hallelujah. He wasn't getting his life back so he could have a vacation. It was to do all the things. You know, they say that if somebody's got a terminal illness, sometimes they make a bucket list of all the things they want to do before they die. But no, he was getting his life back to go up to the house of God and give God his rightful place. So you see, and he says, I'm going to live. Yes, you're going to live. God's heard your cry. He said, well, how do I know that? He said, well, here's a sign. Do you want the sundial to turn forward or to turn back 10 steps? He said, well, it's an easy thing for it to forward because that's what it does. That's what life does. He said, make it go back. And the sundial went back 10 steps. And can I say something to you? Do you know that for God to answer that prayer, God had to turn heaven and earth? He had to move heaven and earth to meet that prayer, but he did it. And I want to encourage you. You know that we can move heaven and earth. And what I would say to you is, what I get from this passage is, you know, sometimes people think about prayer, if it's the Lord's will, if it's this, if it's that, if it's the next thing. It's predestined and it's God's will. So we can pray, but really it's all predecided. I don't think God was pretending when he told Isaiah to tell Hezekiah he was going to die. That was the state of play. But you know, Hezekiah moved the hand of God to change the situation. And we can change the situation with our prayers and our cries and our tears. You know, he bottles up our tears. We can change this world. Or we can be like the kings. We can let it go to be excluded from the presence of God. All these kings were failures. A couple of good kings in Judah. No good kings in David, in Israel, except David, Solomon for a while. And they all failed. But we don't have to fail. We can pursue God and believe God. I was telling you that wee story about going down to Devon. You know, when I got to Devon, probably the same day that guy in the sports car dropped me off. Can't remember exactly. I'm sure it was actually. Because I don't remember spending the night anywhere else. When I got to Devon to painting, before I checked up and caught up with my mate, I said, well, I better find a campsite. I had a wee tent, I didn't have much money, and I had my backpack. So I was along, the sun was shining, and there was a woman. I said to her, excuse me, can you help me? She said, what is it? I said, could you tell me where the campsite is? She said, oh yes, of course I can. And she starts to explain it. I got up a hill, I remember that, and she explained where the campsite was. I said, thank you very much. And God bless you. And I moved on. And when I walked past her, she shouted on me. She said, oh, she says, I like what you've got in the back of your rucksack. Because it said in the back, travelling for Jesus. I hope you're travelling for Jesus. I hope your whole life is a journey for Jesus, with Jesus and for Jesus. So I said, oh, you're a Christian? She said, oh, yes, she says, I'm a Christian. She says, can I tell you my story? I said, I'd love to hear your story. And this lady told me her story. She said, when I was a child, she says, I was knocked down by a car and I was taken to a Paignton Royal Infirmary. I think that's the name of the hospital. I should know it because I ended up in it on that holiday, by the way. I got a fish shooting my finger and I had to go to the same hospital that the woman was talking about. But she said, I was taken to the hospital and I was pronounced dead on arrival. I was taken, certified as dead, and my body was put into the hospital mortuary. I was laid on a slab in the mortuary. They contacted my mother, and they told my mother the news. She said, your daughter has been knocked down in a road traffic accident, and I've got bad news, she's been killed. Now, she said, my sister heard the news. She saw her mother in a flood of tears and crying and crying and crying. She said, my sister went to her room because her aunt, that was her mother's sister, had just died, and her mother couldn't handle it. The grief was just killing her. And now suddenly she's told that her daughter's dead. She said, my sister went to her room and she got down on her knees and she cried to God and she said, God, 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 you can't do this to my mum. You cannot do this to my mum. You cannot do this to my mum. God, you've got to give her back my sister. Give us back my sister. And she said, God, you cannot do this to my mum. This is too much. And she cried to God. Now, a nurse went into the mortuary and she said that body moved in the slab, and she got help, and she called them. She said the child that was on the mortuary slab has moved, and they brought her out and they resuscitated her, and she was telling me the story because I asked her where the campsite was. She said her mum became a Christian, her sister became a Christian. She became a Christian, she grew up. She's a whole family became Christian and are Christians to that day. You see, God's prepared to move heaven and earth, to turn things back when the cry is a real, real cry to God. And I want you to learn from that passage. We want to see things changed. Then how big is the cry? How big is the cry? Is it big enough to move the hand of God? To move the hand of God. And I think it's a fantastic passage because although it's full of gloom and life is full of gloom, the nation's full of gloom, when we call in God, he still answers. You know, Hezekiah was told, even at that point, you know, when he was giving his life back, he said, go and tell the leader of my people. God still identified with his people, and God identifies with you today. And I'm praying that your prayer life will become dynamic and powerful, and that you will see things that you have never seen happen in your life before because you've dared to believe God and call upon God. May God bless you in this coming week, and may your faith, as Smith Wigglesworth wrote a book called Ever Increasing Faith, may your faith just go into orbit and get bigger and bigger and bigger. God bless you. Amen. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, we ask for a blessing on your people. We ask for healing and miracle. We ask for power. We ask for deliverance. We ask for encouragement. We pray, Lord, for great things. Lord, give us a burden that we've never had before. And Lord, give us tears, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen.
The Lord is risen today, alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply. Alleluia. Love's redeeming work is done. Alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle won. Alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise. Alleluia. Christ has opened.